Welcome, welcome, welcome once again to New Artists Meet the Pros with your host, myself. I am Michelle Ayers. And boy, we have a great guest with us today. I'm so excited. I can't wait for you guys to see who it is. But I'm sure some of you are familiar with them. We have with us today none other than Kevin Taylor, who was actually the former producer for BET. That's right, Black Entertainment TV. Welcome, welcome, Mr. Taylor. Give it up for him, guys.
Hey, Michelle, good evening, good evening, good evening.
Hey, hey. I don't know what happened to my controls. What's going on here? Well, we're going to still make it happen, right? All right, there we go. I got to give you some applause. Yes. Kevin, thank you so, so much for doing this for me. It's such an honor to have you as a guest. I am so honored because I think...
The pleasure is mine. The pleasure is mine. I love that you're having these, you know, back in the day, there were books like Everything You Need to Know About the Music Industry and stuff that you are picking up the gauntlet of that and walking young artists through like the process. Because at the end of the day, people think it's, you know, get a song, write half a song, sample it, go viral, and you're a millionaire. And in 2022, people are still saying my manager stole all my money.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait that up one second. It's 2022 and they still saying my manager stole all my money with all the resources out. So I'm going to let you wait that up before we even go into it. And then I'm going to let you do formally introduce yourself. Go right ahead. Cause you done said it. So
so many people talk about the glitz and the glamour of the industry that some of the fundamentals still aren't there. And if you don't know how to handle money, you don't know how to handle your money. And if you don't know how to handle your money, and you don't know what percentages are going where, and you don't know how to collect it, and you're shy and don't want to engage the promoter, and then they make you sing, and then you don't get paid, and then you end up not being able to handle it until you entrust somebody, because you don't want to do that part. You just want to be the artist. You just want to be creative. The next thing you know, you don't even have signature on your own checking account.
What? Hello?
And there's a checking account that you don't even know exists.
Thanks.
With your name on it.
You better wake it up. Okay, y'all listen, new artists, listen, there's a checking account and you don't even know your name is on it. What? I'm gonna clap on that because that's serious. What? You don't even know your name is on it. Okay. Now that we got that out of the way, because we're going to dig into it even deeper. I want you to formally introduce yourself. Tell everybody out here who you are and why you stand in authority to say what it is that you say.
So I'm Kevin E. Taylor. I am a son of Washington, D.C., born and raised. I'm a son of D.C. and a father in Newark, New Jersey. So,
Come on.
My degrees are in English, Spanish, and accounting, though I've been a producer, writer, and creative in the industry since 91 when I worked at BET, where I worked formally till 2002 in the building. And then my production company created and supported material for BET till 2018.
Wow.
I worked with everybody, you know, I created a show called Access Granted, one called Lyrically Speaking.
Yes!
I came up to New York just in time to you know, Free had already been selected for 106 in Park, and I did the process of working with the three gentlemen who ended up becoming AJ, right? So it was three
people. That's right.
And, you know, so I did specials for BET. I interviewed everybody from, Diana Ross, Patti LaBelle, Chaka Khan, Luther Vandross, Stevie Wonder, Lena Horne, Tina Turner, Jill Scott, Mary J. Blige, Babyface, Mariah Carey.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the list goes on and on and on and on and on.
I've been blessed to have been in an industry when legend meant something.
Thank you. Wait a minute. Let's just stop right there. you're doing your own interview. You said when we earned the right to be called what?
Legend.
Could you please, Mr. Taylor, give me your definition or the correct definition of the word?
It's mine. I'll be very clear to say that it's mine, but legend. So I want let's take these two. Legend for me is time in service
That's
and
right.
talent that stands the test of time, right? Icon, right? This, you know, in this era now, when you can look at the Apple logo, the Nike logo, somebody can be a bright light and be an icon, because in one album you can know all about them. They can proliferate the world. That does not make them a legend. Legend has time, man. Has time on it. Legend has decades on it. Even that's in right. The ballroom scene, you know, you're not a 12. You're not a young legend. Legends are people who have put in the work, stood the test of time, and brought a consistent level of talent with them. And you know, so when some of these artists, when you travel the world, like it was powerful for me in my junior year in college to be in London, England, and be on the dance floor at a club and hear a DJ remix Aretha Franklin's Respect, and you know, yes. Right in with the contemporary stuff. You know what I mean? Because the song is legend. The song has weight to it. And it had been so popular that Respect was back in the top 10 on yes. the charts 20 years after it had been released.
Wow. That's a legend. That's a super, I gotta give her, wait, I'm putting some respect on Aretha's name. That's a super legend.
The difference is when icons die, they, this is coming to me, I'm gonna say it right, I'm not trying to step on anybody. When right. icons die, they paint pictures. They will put up murals, they will put you on t-shirts. When legends die, they change the name of institutions. They will change the name to the name of a building, to the name of a community, to the name of a theater to bear your name. That's a legend.
Oh, wow. That is awesome. That is so awesome. And speaking of legends, the legendary Force and Diesel, they're going to have you on their show as well.
Great. And I'm so looking forward to that. We got a function not long before the pandemic. If you know, pandemics has just swollen up time so bad.
But yes.
I've got a couple of Force MD stories. One, when they played at the Black Family Reunion in D.C. So that's such a pleasure.
Oh wow, that's awesome! And I wanted to let you know they have a street being named after them. So when you talk about legends, that's what you're talking about. Street names change, baby. What? Come on in here, break it down for us, Mr. Taylor. Break it down for us.
I'm just saying, and to know what it's like, you know. So to work in at BET, I came into BET, you know, as a little boy from the projects who used to watch BET. They asked me, what was the first video that played on BET?
Wow.
Nobody else in the building seemed to know. And I was like, what do you mean? How do y'all not know it's After the Love Is Gone by Earth, Wind & Fire? That was the first video that played on the air. Weren't you? Like, didn't the world freeze for you when BET came on?
Yes, absolutely. But
because I realized that a lot of people didn't come to the conversation with that level of reverence for us as Black people, even in the Black community, it made me odd to the Tina Turners, to the Sade's when... You know, I could say to Sade, before the camera started rolling, December 19th, 1985, Royal Albert Hall, you and the band are just starting your first world tour, your head's back in the ponytail, da 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 da, and you did da 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 da. And then I said, do you leave the stage and you come back and do Is It a Crime and No Ordinary Love? And then you leave the stage again and the audience keeps screaming until you come back and you said, I don't know what to do. And I said, then a young Black boy said, please do Jezebel. And she said, oh, that was you. I said, you don't remember me. She said, I never saw your face, but after that you sat on the ground. I promise you, I never forgot you. Ask me anything you want. And her manager was like, there are things she's not going to talk about.
Oh my
God. But because I came to the table as a fan with a story, she was like, ask me anything you want. Because I think that she felt safe. I'm not going to bring up some stuff that's salacious. It's like, it's connected to your career and your legacy, not where your daughter at. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And so when you're safe with that, you begin to talk about yourself as a fully realized person. So you can say, well, I took the time after that to raise my daughter. I want to fill my fans in on where I was. Not, it's none of your business. It's your concern. And I get that you're concerned. Thank you.
Wow. What a lot of, guys, let me tell you something. You better tap, comment, share. Listen, if you have someone.
My first interview, my favorite singer on the 21st.
Yes, and I love me some Natalie Cole. Remember, you wrote my bio, so you saw she was in that.
Yes,
I
saw.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well, that, you know, I'm sitting at BET as the executive assistant to the woman who ran the music department, and came into BET in March of '91, and I'm sitting around in the music production meetings, and I said out loud, "So, what are we doing for Black Music Month?" They were like, we didn't have any. what do you mean we have no plans? It's Black Music Month. We're the Black Entertainment Network. We
cannot not.
And so I was like, let's do Diva Week. And yeah. my thinking was, I had seen Ed Bradley interview Lena Horne on 60 Minutes. And as huge as Lena Horne was, I thought, why doesn't she ever get a whole show? Like, if this were a Betty Davis interview, if this were a, you know, Katharine Hepburn interview, she'd be the whole show. This is Lena Horne. And here's a funny thing for me, because Black people always say, well, see they. Oftentimes, we don't either. Mm-hmm. So what I thought was, in creating Lyrically Speaking, what would it be like to sit down with our legend? I mean, so that was Diva Week, I'm sorry. And Diva Week was, Donnie Simpson had video, so let's bring in the divas and give them a power, play their videos, and give them their flowers, literally, while they're still here. And so we had Patti LaBelle, Diana Ross, Gladys Knight, Chaka Khan, Natalie couldn't come because she literally, for June of 91, was when she released Unforgettable. So she started a world tour that went for 2 years. And Aretha wouldn't fly. So the other one on the table was, I said, you know, I'm from D.C. So I was like, and then Phyllis Hyman. And my boss was like,
yes.
Do you think she'd be, you know, do you think people would consider her a diva? And I was like, I'm sorry, is this a question? And luckily, Phyllis Hyman was in concert at a venue called the Wolf Trap in D.C., outside of D.C. in Vienna, Virginia. And she and her husband and I went to go see Phyllis in concert just to be like, is she? And Phyllis showed every nuance of her behind. Ooh. And midway through Living All Alone, when she does the whistle.
Yes, I love that.
You go backstage and you book her, you hear me?
Yeah.
Go backstage and you book her right now. And I was like,
you book her right now. No. You right now. No, you're not right now. Right now.
Because lately, you know, with TikTok and all this stuff, a moment that has gone viral is when Phyllis Hyman sneaks up on Patti LaBelle on the set of Video Soul to present her flowers. And I was like,
oh, man.
I made that happen. Phyllis was like, let me do it. Okay, Phyllis Hyman, if you want to go on set and get Patti her flowers. Okay.
Girl
moments, you know, but just that's like, wow, this moment is happening at BBC, and I had anything to do with it. So I went, that was me as her executive assistant. The next year, I became music researcher and record label liaison, getting to write questions and all this stuff. And the next year, the woman who had taken over the music department said, we have, now that she's off tour and getting ready to release a new album, we have an opportunity to interview, to do an interview with Natalie Cole. And I was like, oh my God. And so she said, go home and write questions. And I'm sitting at home writing questions on individual index cards. And then I come back, you know, the next day, and she goes, Natalie was the first Black person to be Best New Artist. Yep. Natalie winning Best Album for Unforgettable was the first time a Black woman has won that award. Yep. So she said, these are great questions. Da, 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 da. And she says, I've decided who's doing the interview. And I promise you, with all I am, Michelle, I'm thinking, Natalie Cole and Donnie Simpson are going to be pretty chocolate brown people with light eyes on the camera. That's going to be nice television. And she said, you're doing the interview. And I was like, I'm sorry, what? I said, for what show? And she said, I don't know, create it. And I was like, huh?
You have to create the show, honey. What?
She said, you've got something special, you know.
And you technical
stuff we can teach you. And so I went home and created a show called Lyrically Speaking. Thinking,
that's right.
It would be the only time it will ever be seen is with Natalie Cole. So if that's my legacy, that I got to interview my diva, my legend.
You want to send me a copy of that.
I've been writing Natalie Cole letters since I was an elementary school student. I would write her letters and send her my report card. And now here I am getting ready to walk in the room to interview her. That's Natalie Cole right there. This ain't no joke. This ain't no game. It's a love thing.
It's a love thing.
And so that, you know, Natalie begat Luther begat Anita, Anita begat Lena, Lena Patty, Stevie. I went to Denmark to interview Tina Turner.
Man, let me tell you, you know how I feel about my Tina. Woo, I love.
Listen, if you haven't gone to Broadway to see Tina the Musical.
Wow. No, I haven't seen it. I'm going.
It is
fire. Oh, my gosh. My goodness. I've definitely got to get there and see it. Have to. And I have to see the Michael Jackson one, too. I heard that was off the chain, too. So definitely going to be making that trip to New York City. tell us more, Kevin. Tell us more. We got, oh, come on, you rolling. Keep us. I don't even ask no questions. You can interview your own self. He interviewed his own self.
This whole idea that, you know, the new artist meets the pros, it's like, at some point I was the newbie, but I didn't come brand new. I came knowing the music, knowing, you know, what I liked, knowing, you know, they used to call it going into the shed. So I knew, you know, I was blessed to have a mom who, so the reason I fell in love with Natalie Cole is because my mother was such a big fan of Nat King Cole. So when Natalie came to television the first time, I knew sonically that Natalie Cole and Nat King Cole must have been related, which meant she was going to be black. You know, and Natalie Cole just opened up the whole world to me, talking about recording her, starting to sing in college. Then her album was called Inseparable. And I was like, black people don't get to use words like that, inseparable. And so,
one of my favorite songs to sing.
And now I used to have to write Natalie. Singer. Right. And I used to have to write Natalie these 10-page letters. Now, young people, like I'm saying to you, if you have somebody that you have a real dedication for, tell your story on your social media and tag them, and you will be surprised.
Yes.
When Fantasia, when Jennifer Hudson, when Leandria, when Rahsaan Patterson, when Eric Roberson, when somebody feels thank you for that, and then inboxes you, you know? That,
yes.
That I'm still friends with Maxwell. I stayed friends with Maxwell because of social media, and I hadn't seen him in 16 years.
Wow, I love him. Oh, God.
But when Natalie died, he said he was the first person to reach out to me. He said, Kevin, I'm sorry to hear about Natalie. I knew how much she meant to you. And I was like, how? What conversation did we have about Natalie Cole? My best friend was like, every conversation you have. I just know, you know, and people think that, you know, that the dream is too big, you know, but you've seen the video of the dude who has Beyonce squat in front of him and say, what's your name? And he says, my name is such and such, you know, Carter Knowles, I'm your husband, you know what I mean? There's a video I just saw of a young man who had gone to see Tina Turner in concert 17 times. And somehow he got there and she knew that he had been there that many times. And when she did Proud Mary, she brought him up on stage because he knew, because he had corrected the girls about where they messed up on their choreography. So she brought him on stage at the last show to do the song with them. So no dream is too big.
But if what we call engagement.
Well, you should always, you know, you should always, 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 always be ready. Always be at open mic.
Yes. Because
I know what it's like, you know, if you Michelle, you've been at a cafe on a Monday night when you're just singing, and then you look over and go, is that Mariah Carey in the corner? Because one of the girlfriends who's your background singer is singing tonight. And Mariah's
And she's there. Oh, absolutely. Yes. No,
Now I'm too scared to get up there because Mariah's here. You better get up there because Mariah's
here. Yeah, get your tail on up there.
You better.
Oh, man, this is good. Go ahead, Kevin. Keep on going. Wow, because this time goes so fast. You know what I'm saying? I look up at the clock. Gosh, we less than 10 minutes. Oh, so just go. I'm not even going to say anything. Just go.
Tell me a subject you want me to talk about.
Well, I want you to tell the artists what you think they need to do in this climate right now to get started.
I'm gonna say this. I mean, I've been blessed beyond measure in my lifetime. But I feel, and I'm gonna say this, what I hope nobody finds me cocky. I say that having to do a level of work that was very Michael Jordan, in a you know, where it was hard work and you found your blessing in other fields. Where some of these young artists today are Steph Curry, it's like you have the capacity with social media and followers and Spotify and putting your own stuff out there. You have the capacity to be your own superstar and build your own dynasty. But so many artists are waiting for some white, black, or rainbow colored savior to sign them. Sign yourself. Set up a room in your house where you can point a key light and your camera at yourself and record your own music videos. That's what we ended up having to do. That's what artists had to do in the pandemic. That was a lot of artists in a club that was empty or in their own basement in a corner and just showing, I can do this. A whole lot of people want pretty, a whole lot of people want pretty pictures. They don't want solid careers.
Oh my God.
Pictures are iconic. Solid careers are legendary. Pretty pictures, click, iconic. They are frozen moments in time. Legendary, legendary. It's Patti LaBelle and Gladys Knight sitting on the stage in Versus. Exactly. Legendary is Ron Isley with a full white beard and having young women
go, looking good. Looking good.
Cat Daddy. I was like, because he kept himself up because he's
that's right.
He's not like, and so the mindfulness that you're in this for a career, not the long haul, as a career. So if you're always ready, somebody can see you in the audience. If you're always ready, somebody that's can right. grab, somebody can reach in and grab you in social media and say, hey, I'm going to be performing in your town. I'd like you to open for me based on some videos you posted. But so exactly. many people are often not ready. You know, when somebody says, hey, come up here and sing a little something. Oh, if you're from old school church, Michelle, we talked about this from old school church. You
really?
Go and be like, Pastor, I've told eight. No, no. And then she get up and go, you know, she's like, that's a little thing. She's walking the point. Right. But the truth is, I've seen Patti LaBelle in concert, Michelle Pharrell in concert, where they had no speaking voice.
And that's right.
Singing voice.
But baby, I done that before. It's done happened. Been there and done it. Absolutely. Right.
So every opportunity is an opportunity to show up. Show all the way up.
And then coming up in church for me, I didn't get a chance to say I couldn't. They threw you on the organ, threw you on the keyboard, threw you in front of the choir. Get up there and sing. Do devotional.
before I bring the word, I'm going to ask my daughter. My daughter Michelle to come up and you're like, oh Lord, and you got from where you sit to the microphone to figure out what you.
That's doing. Right, that's right, and see the old church wrecked out on the floor when you get done when the Lord get finished that, with you. I'm telling you.
Well, that's how you're still able to be so solidly sound in your career when they're young when they're young artists today who get nervous about every little thing, because if you were always doing the thing, nobody could catch you slipping.
That's right. That's so true.
As a preacher, Reverend Taylor, we see you back there. If you could come up and say a few words, okay? Because I'm paying attention.
Be ye also ready.
Be ye also always ready.
That's right. That's right.
You know, you might be in an audience somewhere. You might be at a funeral and they go, "Oh, the singer didn't show." Okay. All right. Mama got to be sent home in style. Let me sing the song. If you stay ready, you don't have to get ready.
Say that again so the people in the back can hear you real good.
If you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. And the point of that is again, for me to be in Sydney Mahmood's office, I speak her name, you know, who was senior vice president at BET, and when she said, you're doing the interview, and I'm like, and let me tell you what really happened. So when she said, you're doing the interview, I walk into the Sheraton Peninsula Hotel in New York City, room 1603. I will never forget it. And we set up the whole, that's where that picture was taken. We set up the whole thing, and then Natalie arrives. That's my first time in front of Natalie. And she takes my face in her hand and kisses me like we old friends. I'm like, you don't know me. You know my letters. And so she goes, oh my God, I can't believe you're here. And then, because she knows I work at BET now, and she knows who I am to her, she goes, she's thinking like BET let me come to be in the room while Natalie Cole was being interviewed. So she said, so who's doing the interview? I said, me. She said, oh, hell no. And I was like, oh. And you know, I'm a young
This is transparent. This is some good content. This is transparent.
Oh, no, she's saying I'm not good enough. She's saying I'm not an actual journalist. She's saying this ain't going to be a real interview. And she saw that on my face. She said, no, baby. She said, no, Kevin, I'm saying you have forgotten stuff about my career that I'll never remember. And I was like, oh, it's okay, Natalie. I'll walk you through your career. She's like, you're going to walk me through my career. And I proceeded to do just that. So you know when an artist will say, when you mention a song, and I say that was either on my second or third album. It was on your third album. It was the fourth song. She's like,
wow. She was amazed, right?
She's like, but here's what's funny. The next year, wait for this moment. The next year, Nancy Wilson was in D.C. to do a concert for Bob Johnson, the president of BET, because he was on the board of governors for this music school. He brought in Nancy Wilson, and her assistant, Ed Roebuck, couldn't make the trip because it was just a weekend. He couldn't make the trip with her. So I got to call out, meet Nancy Wilson at the airport and stay with her all weekend because you do divas. And I was like, okay. And so... And so that Friday, Mr. Johnson's having a party at his home, the mansion, for Nancy Wilson. And I'm standing at the front door as I've just walked in with Ms. Wilson, kind of big dude, almost looking bodyguard, but I'm not a bodyguard. And so she's talking to someone, and somebody covers my eyes, and I was like, who would cover my, it must be a coworker from BET. And I turn around, and it's Natalie Cole. And she kisses me and hugs me, goes, oh my God, I didn't know you'd be here. And then while she's still hugging on me, she reaches over to hug Nancy Wilson. So I'm stuck between Nancy Wilson and Natalie Cole. I'm the meat on a Natalie Cole, Nancy Wilson sandwich. And I'm like, how is this happen? How is this my life? But that weekend, after she hugged me, Natalie said to me, you'll be happy to hear that I signed a book deal and I'm going to need you. Okay.
This is getting good.
And when her book came out, I wish, can I put my hands on it? But if you go to Natalie Cole's Angel on My Shoulder, which became an award-winning television movie, the last person in, there's a paragraph about that big to be dedicated in the dedication. The last photo is me and Natalie, and the last 12 pages were written by me.
You better go ahead with yourself.
It says Natalie is a Natalie Cole discography compiled and annotated by Kevin E. Taylor.
Don't forget the E. And the E is for what? What's the E for?
Edward.
All right.
Which is beautiful to me because I think my that might be why I did it. My mother, my middle name is Edward, and my mother's from Edwards, Mississippi.
All right. That's all right. Man, wow. Kevin, we got let me see, 1 minute left. Wow, didn't I tell you? It just felt like we was talking for 5 minutes. It goes so fast. I got to have you back for part 2, 3, 4, and 5.
Let's talk because I really, so for me, this is really important. This is the stuff to be able to pour into artists. And they don't have to be young artists to be new artists.
That's right.
Because if you're out there and you think your break hasn't happened, let me give you what God gave me not long ago to preach to my congregation. If you're not dead, God's not done. Alberta Hunter got discovered at 77. Olita Adams was singing at piano at a Holiday Inn in Kansas when two white pop boys from Europe discovered her and took her on the road.
Yes.
Don't let your opportunity catch you slipping. Be doing what you want to be doing so that somebody can bless you to do it.
Oh my gosh. And that's the words of Kevin E. Taylor. Kevin, gosh, thank you so much. I need an hour show. Hello, television station. I need an hour show.
Do it in two parts. I'll be back. You say, look.
We've got to do three because there's so much information. Oh my gosh. This was so awesome.
Look, how about this, Michelle? Let your audience ask questions. Take the questions from them and we'll do it next time.
Yes, that's what we're going to do the next time. Y'all give it up for Mr. Kevin E. Taylor. Oh, my God, he's definitely coming back. That's going to be a part 3, 4. Once again, you can see us on the Raven International Network on the Roku channel and on Amazon TV. We're also on I think I'm going to have you come back and do the radio station, too. We're on iHeartRadio, Power Me Up Radio. Now, look in the streaming channels for Raven International Network. Kevin, thank you. It was wonderful. I can't wait to have you back again. We're going to talk after the show. Guys, this is I Am Michelle, and thank you for checking in to New Artists Meet the Pros. Bye-bye.
It's like we're not going anywhere. Maybe it's because there's something in the air. And I don't even care. No, no, I don't even care anymore. It's like we're losing all track of time. I just got one thing on my mind. Baby, one day I'm hoping. Thank you.